All right, welcome to our Saturday training class. This is my favorite service of the month because I always get a lot of good questions, question and answer period. My goal is sitting here in this room right now. If you look at that woman right there and that one, the one fiddling with her hair, and those two back there, okay, this guy sitting here. When they first started out, they couldn't pray their way through a wet paper bag. And they had no idea what they were doing. They themselves were in bondage. And now they're blowing devils out of people like shotguns. And wounds and everything coming out. They've healed so many people, it's ridiculous.
Holy Spirit, yeah.
And I'm trying to replicate that. Okay? That was my goal. Yeah, and it's slowly working. I need more of that. I'd like to double it. Then after I double it, I'd like to double it again. Yeah, I'm a very greedy person. But that's the purpose of it, getting people ready to go. They get delivered first. They repent of their sins, then they deliver and heal others. And that's how the gospel works. It's in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. It couldn't be any clearer. And that's how God sets the system up. And so when I read it there, I said, well, I'm going to try and replicate what I see there. And that's what I saw the church was not doing. They were setting up self-sustaining systems, which is a failure. You want to equip and help get people filled with the Holy Ghost, ready to go, fighters, spiritually trained, you know, so that they don't need me anymore. I'm a non-entity. They just go on and kill it. And if you do that in a church, you'll get thrown out because there's jealousy, there's a hierarchy there, and if you buck that system, you draw red flags. I was in the systems, I drew red flags. But in this system here, I'm trying to do the opposite. I want people to grow like weeds, start their own ministry, and get out there and kill this thing. Without me, they don't need me, they got the Holy Ghost. I did a teaching on my podcast on Sunday mornings. I do a 9 o'clock a.m. podcast now. And I was doing the teaching on, you know, what I've done before on getting divorced. And I was showing what Jesus was saying in Matthew 5 and so on. And I explained that God allows you to get divorced for fornication. And then I explained what fornication was. And the difference between that and adultery, okay? So some friend of mine from the old days back at the Dream Center in Scottsdale years ago sends me a Facebook message. You need to get a hold of, I heard your teaching this morning, and you need to get a hold of such and such so-and-so because there's a lot more reasons why you can get divorced. And she listed a bunch of them like that. I said, hey, I'm on board. What's the scriptural background for that? What scriptures do I use to prove that? And she had none. Not a one. She told me to contact that guy. That happened today. Familiar spirits. See how that? Brainwashed. They take your mind. That woman that contacted me is an intelligent person. Teacher. Didn't have one scripture to prove. And the reason that she was doing that was because I met her husband and knew him. He wouldn't come for deliverance. She came for deliverance, but she wouldn't submit and repent. We couldn't get any demons out of her. This is years ago, like was it 20 years ago? What was that? When I was over at the Dream Center. So the deliverance flopped with that whole family. Her son had severe bipolar. You couldn't get any demons out of him. He wouldn't repent. The whole thing was a total flop. Her husband, was nuts. he was a teacher too. Kindergarten teacher, first grader, third grade, and she left him. She couldn't take it anymore. Guy's a nut. Okay, so when she heard my teaching, she started to fill her depends while she was driving. What do you mean? Because her husband didn't fornicate. Okay, so she had got divorced because he was a horse's patoot. Like everybody who gets divorced, they get a divorce because their spouse is a certified card-carrying psycho. Well, so then she said, oh God, I can't believe he said that. You know, I've heard Brother Mike, I respect him as a teacher, but now this has hit me in the gut. Okay? So she immediately sends me a message to fix me. And then I said, oh, that sounds good. I'll go ahead and teach that. Could I have the scriptures you're using to say that you can divorce your husband if he's got dirty underwear? There was no scriptures. I don't have any. And so then click. I'm telling you, those are the demons that told her you can divorce someone for any reason. That's what the Pharisees told Jesus. Is it legal to divorce your spouse for any cause? That's what they said to him. He said, no, but there is one cause that allows you to divorce, and that is fornication. And then I explained what fornication was, which is all forms of sexual sin. Adultery is only a portion of fornication. Adultery is heterosexual sex. So if you had sex with the opposite sex, that's adultery. If you had the sex with the same sex, that's fornication. All grounds for divorce. Your husband is a porn addict. Ground for divorce. Your husband's a pedophile. Grounds for divorce. Your husband was fooling around with Lassie. Grounds for divorce. Fornication. But she didn't have that, so she panicked and had to straighten me out. So then I flipped it on her. I didn't say she was wrong. I didn't criticize her. I just said, may I please have the scriptures supporting that so I can include it in my teaching? I'm not going to get up here and teach something that I don't have any support for at all. Come on. But I said, I just told you that story to show how subtle it is. It's so subtle. Yeah.
So I haven't actually formulated this well, but I've got a lot of good insight from Kenneth Hagin when he was operating just pure Holy Ghost. Good scripture that he quoted, why you cannot pray out a demon. Don't ask God to do anything about demons. A lot of scripture about love. I mean, so I followed him for a while, but I remember you mentioning that at some point he cracked up.
Right.
And just this week I saw a video of him, and I'm like, oh my God, this must be it. It's like a 20-minute video, and he's got like, I don't know, 7,000 people in his audience. And he's going up to his different ministers. He just taps them on the cheek. Like the first one he tapped. The guy jumped up, ran over to the altar, jumped on the podium, which is about 4 feet high, jumped into the garden or something. He's going to everybody just saying, all right, I need somebody to wrap it up. He gives the people a microphone. And all of a sudden they can't talk. They just start cracking up and stuff. So I guess that would be an example of a great man. But somehow, how did he get infiltrated? I mean,
well,
doesn't matter, but the point is, he
died. Thanks. Thanks for Joe getting ahead of my teaching. That's a giant buzzkill. Okay, so let's get done with this so I can go to Joe's division. Okay, any last questions about do not recommend these ministries anymore. If you want to recommend them on your own or you want to go there on your own, that's your business. I don't tell people how to live their lives. It's not my job. This is my job here. Anything? Anybody mad at me right now? Mm-hmm. You mad at me? You're mad?
True.
Why?
I'm just kidding. I'm not mad.
Where's Pete? Is he mad at me?
Reservation.
He mad at me?
Mad.
He's mad?
He's not mad.
All right. Well, these people that are mad at me, that's the way it goes. I just move forward. Yeah. Too bad.
Amen.
There we go. Don't worry about that anymore. Now, let's go over this one real quick. We'll do our quick refill here. You know how human beings are made. If you don't, you can't do proper deliverance with them because you don't know where the root problem is coming from. If you don't get to the root, it'll manifest again later, right? So your soul is where your emotions come out of. If you have soul wounds or you're emotionally ill, that's your soul. The devil uses your soul and the Holy Spirit uses your spirit man. Your spirit man is where the Holy Spirit lives. This thing is perfect in the eyes of God. When the trumpet sounds, your spirit man hears it, and poof, you go. Even though you might be emotionally jacked up, or you've got sicknesses in your body, it doesn't matter. Bang, you're going. Perfecto. Right in there. Perfect. Jacked up. Still go. Perfect. This is perfect. This is where your giftings come out of. Your anointing, your giftings. Comes out of there. The Kundalini, the familiar spirits, they attack your soul. And that's where Hagen then got tricked. He went into the soulish manifestations of hysterical laughter and people going nuts. And they tricked him. He was a great man of God, just fantastic. He was in another league from the rest of us. And your mind is the seat of your free will, and your mind determines what happens between you and God. It does not. Not determined by God. It's determined by you. God said, here's all the promises. You choose which one you're going to use in your life. If you decide not to use any of them, then you stay addicted, you stay stupid, you stay lost, you have nothing, you can't help anybody, you're a spiritual failure because you chose to be a failure. Here's all the blessings. You can choose these. Or you choose to be a screw-up. It's all based on your free will. Because God already said, this is my will. This is for you. This is yours. That's my will. Here it is. Here's your healing. Here's your deliverance. Here's your ministry. Here's your destiny. There it is. I want you to have it. My son bought it for you. You... at any time can tell the Lord to go screw himself and just leave, and he will not stop you. Angels and humans have free will. They choose whom they will serve. This day, says the Lord, behold, I set before you life and death, blessings and cursing. Therefore choose life, that you and your family may live. He said, you choose. Okay, you chose porn this week, okay, chose that this week, okay. If you choose to repent, then you'll get forgiven for that this week. If you choose not to repent, that's your business, God lets you do it. So we're going to get a lot of people in here with... they think they want deliverance, but then when they find out, ooh, gosh, this requires repentance. Ooh, I don't know. Let me think about it. Then you let them think about it. You don't try to force them. You know, don't waste your time and your energy on somebody who's not ready to repent. This is why the altar deliverance method doesn't work very well. Okay? You sit the person down there. It's basically a soul wound healing method. So sit down there, and then you divide soul and spirit. And then you start talking to the demons. How'd you get in there? What are you doing there? Then you tell them, are you going to leave? No, I'm not. Oh, you're going to go to the courts of heaven and get your butt kicked. No, I don't want to go there. You going to leave? No, okay. That method is fairly effective for soul wounds, but very poor for deliverance of demons, because it's not a repentance-based system. Have you ever seen that done before, that altar? I got a friend of mine that's the best at the business at it, period. Nobody better than him. I've seen it done a dozen times. He's an absolute expert. The demons just come right back. Why? Because in the third portion of the Great Commission, Jesus said that you are to go into all nations and you are to preach repentance and forgiveness of sins in my name. Luke 24. It specifically says repentance. So if I do an altar method on you, I didn't get you to repent of unforgiveness for your mother. Well, that dropped a curse on you. So now I'm doing altar deliverance on somebody who's cursed. I'm supposed to do that? I don't think so. I don't buy that. No. You got a problem with your mother. Let's get that. Right, Erica? You get that done right away. You don't go anywhere until that's fixed. Right? The Father said that, period. We're not going to the courts of heaven. We're going to go down here on our knees. I don't need any courts of heaven. I got heaven. I got the Word of God. All right. How'd that go? Okay, so you could be a super-powered minister, Hagen, okay? Upper echelon of anointings. This guy was a monster for decades. And you can have an illness in your body, or you can have a wound in your soul and still be a monster minister with a huge anointing. Happens all the time. You see these guys with giant anointings, and you see them crash like a 747. Right? Happens all the time. Oral Roberts, boom. A.A. Allen, boom. Massive anointings. The devil got in here. He got in here. Crash. It's common. The devil tricks everybody with their anointing, okay? He uses their anointing, which is legitimate, and then he works on your mind, and he tells the person, if you have a high anointing, you are a wonderful person, and you have a great character, and you're a wonderful, godly man or woman of God. He's lying. Why? He wants you to take your eyes off the Lord and put it on this super anointed person. Oh my gosh. They're so great. They can't do anything wrong. And if you say anything against that person, they come after you. You're dividing the body of Christ. I've heard every criticism in the world against me. Every one of them. I got all of them. I got a bag of them. You've got to understand your character can be flawed, but your anointing can be high. Because the Bible teaches when God gives you a gift, He never takes it back. So you could get the gift of this and that and this and that, and then decide to quit and become a pimp. You can speak in tongues while you're scheduling John's for sex.
Whoa.
Did anybody hear what I said?
Oh, yes.
Okay, I'll say something stupid again. You can go into organized crime and speak in tongues while you're robbing the store. Because God gives gifts and he doesn't take them back.
Can I share an example? Back when Pete was still using, he'd be totally high on heroin and he'd pray with people and get healed.
Right.
And he would pray people into the kingdom too. They get saved. Right there, you know?
Wow. Oh, yeah.
He prayed for me and I got healed, but he was totally...
Right. So what she said was Pete's healing was coming out of his spirit, man.
Yeah.
But his body was still addicted to drugs. See that? Joe.
So are you suggesting that your anointing is not proportional to your sanctification?
Yes. You can backslide and still keep your anointing. You can decide to quit your sanctification. Can't you?
The gifts and calling is hard.
The gifts and calling is not going to be retracted. You can retract them.
Okay.
You can do whatever you want. You pimp.
And that's quenching the anointing.
It'll quench the anointing, but the gifts are not going to be withdrawn from you.
Right.
So when you see somebody on TV with these massive anointings and giftings, it does not mean they are good people.
Yeah.
They could be con artists.
What's the difference between the gifts and the anointing?
The anointing runs the gift. So you got the gift and you plug it in. The gift manifests, you know? The anointing is kind of like the electricity and boom, the Ferrari. Elon Musk. See how I threw that in?
Oh, yeah. That's great.
You didn't get that, did you? See, it's elevated. What?
So it seems like sometimes when you're not in obedience with the Holy Spirit, the flow doesn't come through.
The anointing doesn't, yes. You can quench your anointing, sure.
The gift is still there.
The gift is,
the
right. Right.
The electricity is not going through.
And you can plug it back in quickly because the blood of Christ allows you to repent fast. It could be seconds, or minutes, or a day, or what have you.
It doesn't mean it has gone away.
No, it hasn't gone away. It's only been muffled.
Hindered.
Right, 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 right. So you can have this great minister, who's a horse's patoot. It happens all the time. Ministers fall all the time. Don't look at me like you don't know what I'm talking about. It happens all the time. And I'm trying to explain how it happens. The mechanics of it is what I'm doing right now. I'm not trying to convince you it happens. You already know it happens. Right? It's just common. This is like another thing. Yeah.
So I'm seeing this in operation where the minister has a great anointing, he, she, whoever, and they're still operating in the gift.
Right.
But their character, right?
Stunk.
Right. So the anointing might be quenched. Two things I'm going to ask. So their anointing is quenched. So if their character was higher, their anointing would be higher, is what you're saying? Because
no.
While they're... Okay.
No.
So what do we mean by quenched?
No.
I think it like is...
It's not a A or B. It's levels. Varies with each person. Quenching, anointing. So let's say you got the gift of healing. Wigglesworth had the gift and you got it, okay? But his manifests with stuff. I got a little anointing for healing, but I don't have Wigglesworth's anointing because I don't get creative miracles. I don't get quadriplegia. I went over it last night. You know, I got a little barrier there. Okay, so his charge, higher than my, I plug it in, it goes to here, so to speak. The gift is that, but the energy, anointing behind it, the power behind it is different with each person. Everybody has a different anointing. No one is like Everybody's like fingerprints. Everything's different.
Mike, do you think that that has to do with the measure of faith that you were given?
Yeah, well, in fact, faith is a gift. So Wigglesworth had the gift of faith, and when he plugged it in, it goes to here. Well, I plugged it in, it went here.
I was just thinking about our character is reflecting God's character.
Right, supposed to.
Yeah, that's what it's, I mean, that's really the goal, right?
That's a goal, sanctification, right?
And so when we see people with anointing, we've seen a lot of this, it doesn't actually give glory to God because it's not, you don't see it in their character. The gifts might be there, we've seen a lot of false stuff too, but it's the character of the person that comes through that I think attracts people to Christ. Because they see Christ in it. It's not, to me, it's not giving glory to God.
Now, what you're talking about there is not what I'm talking about. But your point is valid. The goal is to be Christ-like and have a Christ-like character. That should be all of our goals. Does that happen? No. It happens individually, differently, like fingerprints. Everybody has a different character, a different anointing, even if they got the same gift. Correct?
Yes.
You didn't hear me on. Everybody has a different character. Okay? Nobody's exactly the same. No one, even in families. They're different. Even twins are different. Okay. Your character is tied into your conscience. And your conscience is the center of your morality. So let's say your character allows this, but his doesn't. Click. Conscience. Everybody has a different conscience. The goal, like you said, is to have the conscience of Christ. Nobody's perfect, and everybody goes up and down. And here, God will not take back what He gave you. He doesn't do that. So when you're ministering to somebody, if they've had these gifts and they no longer operate, or they were doing that and it's not working anymore, you tell them the truth. You can be restored and I'll help you. God wants you restored. He wants you healed. And let's get back on the treadmill and you go for it. And that's not word of faith enthusiasm crap. That's telling the person the truth. You can be forgiven and restored. Sarah was. I taught on it last night. Sarah was a certified screw-up. But she got forgiven.
Two-part question. I want you to expand more on what you mean by up and down. Maybe some examples. And to kind of piggyback on what Danny said, my son said to me, I could smoke up in the morning and lead someone to Christ in the afternoon.
Right.
He said, no, it doesn't work that way. Was I incorrect in telling him it doesn't work that way?
Well, now it depends on what you define work as. Yeah. Is it able to work that way? Yes. Right. Is that God's will? No.
See, I didn't believe it was
God, because he has a flawed character. He has a physical addiction. He has demons in his body pushing him to take drugs. But he has an anointing for soul winning. See that? So you can have a flawed person doing wonderful things for God.
So those demons are in your soul, in your body, mind. Isn't that going to cause a huge cloud over your anointing?
Yeah, sure.
I mean, that's going to...
Yeah.
And the Bible says your sin will find you out, so sooner or later
your
character's going to be swagged.
You're going to reap what you sow.
Yeah.
Everybody reaps what they sow. It's the law of God. It's like gravity.
He's going to be a very effective minister.
Well, not for long. I mean, if his son keeps doing that, the devil's eventually kill him. But he didn't ask me that. He asked me, is that possible? And I'm trying to explain the mechanics of how it's possible. It sounds like I'm a heretic. But if you understand how this breaks down, you can see how people can operate in their anointing, yet be this rotten person under these circumstances. But under these circumstances, they look like John the Baptist, like Pete. Pete was John the Baptist, see? And then he's, oh, that's people to Christ, hallelujah. Boom. See that? Physically.
The activity, Mike, real quick, is they're really going to press in on you. I mean, you're anointed in the afternoon after taking meth in the morning. I mean, those demons that are causing the addiction, they're going to make sure that you die quick.
Of course.
Or go insane.
Of course. Well, he didn't ask me that.
Yeah.
He didn't ask me that question. I was just explaining what he said. What you said is valid. Yeah, you play around with the devil, he'll kill you. Period. It doesn't matter who you are. He can take out anybody. Yeah.
I'm just wondering if there's a bigger picture to this, that God is so merciful, he'll use unqualified people to deliver his mercy, especially in the sight that there's nobody that has ever worked for God that is qualified, except Jesus Christ.
Yeah, of course, it's 1 Corinthians chapter 1. We all fall into that category. What I'm trying to show is the mechanics of how it works.
Amen.
Everybody is flawed.
Yes.
And everybody at one time used to be a super suck. But that's called redemption. That's called mercy. That's called grace, which I had to scrape in by the truckload to get anywhere. I was a super duper size. I was just pulling, I suck, and I had a big ass on my chest. Mercy caught me. Not me, my ability. I got no ability. Yeah.
I have another question.
Oh, yeah, fire away.
Maybe it's off topic, but when you're teaching somebody else how to have discernment, and, you know, you don't want everybody to lay hands on you, which I know. But I'm just saying, I understand the concept, I understand the scriptures and all of what you're saying.
Concept of what?
Is you have to have discernment when somebody is teaching you or somebody is praying for you. And so if I know that the person's character isn't any good, I don't care how sick I am, I'm not letting that person pray for me.
Yeah, good idea.
And when I'm teaching people to have discernment, I need to be able to show them and explain to them how when you're looking at the person's character, that's part of the proof, A, that they're saved and that their gift is what's God's will, not just that they have a gift, but it's God's will, and it's not going to mislead them, because I've seen that happen, where a person has a gift, but their character is not the character of Christ. So people go to that person and they get healed, they get delivered, and then it all comes back on them because they've submitted in a way that they shouldn't, because they didn't test it to see if it was really from God. Because it's very hard to discern what is from God. How do we do that? And I understand the concept about having the gift and God doesn't remove the gift. We've seen that. But then, you know, how do you teach somebody discernment so that they know? Because the enemy is very good at imitating. Extremely good.
Okay, now that was a long question, and there was a lot of trails in that question. But discernment is bifurcated. There's the gift of discernment, and then there's discernment that I'm trying to do today. I'm trying to teach you how to recognize spiritual things. Okay? This isn't the gift of discernment in operation. Huh? So my point was, if you run into somebody who has a bad character, you're not going to know it normally, particularly an evangelist or something. You don't even know the person. So they could be Jack. But they may also have legitimate anointings and giftings. So if you know about them, like she said, yeah, I would recommend you not let them lay hands on you. Absolutely. Those people in Hagen's ministry near the time he died, they should have never let him put hands on them. They would fly out of their chairs, vibrate up to the altar like, it was terrible. And that proves that no matter how high your anointing is or how intelligent you are, you can get tricked. Anybody can be tricked.
Is there such a thing as a demonic healing?
Yeah. Yeah, I'm not talking about that. That's not what I'm talking about right now. But I'm talking about if they have legitimate gifts from God. God, not demons. Yeah. Now, the familiar spirits, they'll do fake healings, temporary healings. Todd Bentley, textbook example. Lots of healings. Lots of healings falling out. Todd Bentley, textbook. Terrible character. Terrible. All kinds of sex. It's terrible. Big. Beautiful anointing. Pretty good preacher. Led all kinds of people to God. Lots of healings. The classic of what I'm talking about here. Yeah, thanks for saying that. That couldn't be a better poster child for this. Guy had conscience problems, integrity issues, but, pretty powerful man of God there. When he wasn't sinning, committing adultery and everything. If you get past that, you get good stuff. So a point I'm trying to make is that when you meet someone, you don't know about that person's background. You got to be careful with everyone because you don't know them. So you don't have to be afraid of anybody, but you just, use caution. Use your discernment. Look for little red flags, That's how you do it, yeah.
If your desire is to really be godlike and you recognize in yourself, and you have your anointing or whatever it may be, but you recognize these character flaws in yourself, is deliverance the answer on these character flaws? Repentance,
no.
The answer to these character flaws?
Repentance is, deliverance alone won't work if the person doesn't repent and renew their mind. Deliverance is not an effective method.
Repentance is the answer to character flaws when you recognize it in yourself.
Yes. Character flaw, you recognize yourself, then you cast the demons out. See? Nobody will get rid of something they don't know they have. Or God hasn't enlightened it. That's the purpose of trials. So if I'm God, I'm going to hit this person. Boom! Something bad happened to him. Now what's going to happen? This is going to manifest. That's going to manifest over your trial. And God's using the trial to expose what needs to be removed. Okay? And you can't do that if you're blessing somebody. Blessings doesn't work. Only in adversity will you change. And so God says, listen, there's no temptation taking you such as common to man. You're never going to get adversity beyond what you can handle. So you can keep on believing last night. You can keep your pistis going because you're not going to get hit with anything more than you're able to handle. God gave you that promise. But you're going to get hit like Hebrews 11. And then these things are going to manifest that need to be removed. Negative thinking, self-pity, self-hatred, frustration, anger toward God. All that stuff starts popping up. And that's God in his mercy, like Joe said, showing you, hey, I'm pointing that out to you through this adversity. Let's get rid of that.
Praise God.
He usually uses The demons usually use people, and they think they're attacking them and winning, but the Holy Ghost saw it coming before they did it, and now he's manipulating them.
Praise God.
Oh. Face kicking on the way. He saw the temptation come before you got it. He said, oh, okay, well, I'll let it go there, and then I'll point out that. Then we'll reverse field on him.
So a lot of this is just an inside job.
Yeah, a big one.
Yeah, you have to recognize your flaws, but, you know, a lot of people don't, though. I mean, they'll go red, burn green, and
that's an inside job. It sure is. Big time. Big time. Now, when you're reading through your Bible, be careful. This word is deceptive. Cardia is a Greek word. Your heart. It means your heart. This word here, heart, is used to describe you don't know what. It depends on what the text is, context of the text. But it's something about your inner man, your heart. Your belly was used a couple times. That's kolia. That means your kidneys. It doesn't mean your actual heart or kidneys. It means your inner man coming from the depth of your, out of their belly shall flow rivers of living. It doesn't mean your belly kidneys. It means your inner man. See? Out of your inner man come the issues of life, Solomon said. Right? So when you see that term, just park it there for a second, see what the context of it is, and then you know what the heart is talking about. But it's something about the inner man.
You know, you're talking about somebody having a gift of healing, which applies to healing other people, not the gift of healing oneself, okay? I mean, if somebody has a bad character, they need some healing. And even if they're healing somebody else, it's God that is or not going to heal them. Because, I'm not familiar with people that have the gift of healing themselves without healing from God. God is the great healer. It says so right in the scripture, right? You know, we lived in Malaysia, and an evangelist from India came through. This guy, I won't give his name, but he billed himself as being the Billy Graham of India. He had these big rallies, and there were a lot of people that attended these rallies. First of all, there's a lot of people in India for the first place, and second of all, these rallies were free, so people that don't have anything will go to about anything if it's free, right? So this guy came in, and he started having a healing ministry in Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia. And this guy was so prideful that I couldn't even listen to him. I went out in the hallway while he was talking. And so he went from there back to India. But in the meantime, we knew people in Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia, where they had been healed at this guy's. And you know, what you're talking about tonight is in line with this. This guy's character was flawed. He went back to India, and on the way from the airport home, he, his wife, and daughter had a traffic accident. The daughter was killed. And so this guy, he told everybody, the whole world, that he was going to resurrect his daughter, bring his daughter back to life. And that, of course, didn't work, right? Anyway, other things happened, but he came back to another meeting in Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia, and I'm telling you, he was like a totally different person. His character had been changed, and I would argue that it had been changed by God. So some of these guys that maybe can heal other people, the question is, can they heal themselves?
Okay, now, man, that was a tough bunch of statements. So what I was talking about earlier was the gift of healing, which very few people have. And then I mentioned Wigglesworth. Okay? healing doesn't require the gift of healing. It's for every born-again Christian. It's part of the Great Commission. Mark chapter 16. They shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. Okay? So I don't have the gift of healings, but I've seen hundreds of people healed. Okay? So having the gift of healing or not having it has nothing to do with you being healed. That's between you and God. Yeah. Then, well, the other thing you said there earlier, I was saying that God allows tribulation to come into your life to get you to see that you have conscience or character issues that need to be fixed. Daughter died. So that's telling me, and I don't know anything about him, so I'm just guessing, probably a legitimate man of God who had integrity issues and conscience problems, and the father in mercy took the daughter to get him to change. And apparently it worked from what he said. I don't know if it worked. This is the first time I heard the story. But it sounds like the Holy Ghost, from my experience, which I have seen dozens of times before. So God was trying to get through to the guy to get him to change. Okay? Now some people's character is so bad, their conscience is so rotten, their minds are so deluded that only a trauma event will get through to them. Trauma event. Okay? Which will bring me over here in a minute. And so that's what that guy got. He was apparently so gone that some bad, really bad thing had to happen to snap him. And it worked. He repented from what he was saying. See that? So that is exactly what I've been teaching here. That evangelist, he got consumed with pride. He had a great anointing for evangelism or something. Then he's been seeing all these people healed. Now, everybody knows we don't heal anybody. When I say you have the gift of healing, that's not me doing it. Everybody knows that's the Holy Ghost, right? When I say that, I'm not saying we have all these gifts. They're given to us. We don't have nothing. We get it from Christ the healer. Okay, so I'm not saying the person. Now, if you go into this person actually healing something, now we're back over with familiar spirits. Now we're into voodoo. Now we're into witchcraft. Now, I'm not talking about that. I was talking about legitimate Christians who are born again, who pray for somebody and have them healed. And that's what all Christians can do. Any Christian can pray for someone and have them delivered and healed. That's what it says specifically in the Great Commission. It's not a gift. It's yours. But again, here's all your gifts. You take what you want. God never forces you to take gifts. He wants volunteers. See? And so Pete used to win people to Christ. He was on drugs. And then the Holy Ghost started working on his conscience. And he started saying, man, I got to get off of drugs. And I got to change my life. And I got to repent. And then God used a bunch of adversity to knock Pete around. And so then he changed. Right? And now he's a wonderful person. But he totally different than what he was. Which is the goal of Christianity, is you become a new person.
And my son is also.
His son repented, okay? But before he was...
Teen challenge, yeah.
He went through teen challenge, okay? Now, don't get me started on that. So is there any questions here on how this thing works? So the next time you see a whacked out preacher, and you're going, man, a lot of good things are happening, but he seems like an idiot. Now you're not even worried about it anymore. You're going, oh, I understand that. Brother Mike, it's this, it's that, it's the, oh, I got it. Put it together. I'm good with it. Go ahead and heal him. See, people who don't understand how this works, they just go like this. Oh, that's the devil. He's got a bad character, and that person got healed. That's satanic healing. What may not be a satanic could be legit. Well, they got a bad character. That's all Satan. No, it isn't. It is not. Well, just consider, Well, consider this then. When this person got saved, you weren't there. When this person got filled with the Holy Ghost, you weren't there. When this person went into the ministry, you weren't there. You're here when they're having character issues and flaws. You weren't there when Benny Hinn was crying out to God as a teenager, begging God for mercy, worshiping God like crazy. All you see is a comb over and a TV fraud. But that's here. You weren't there when Billy Graham got what God gave him. See? Am I a Benny Hinn fan? No, I can't stand the guy. I love his anointing that he got here when I wasn't there. Man, you weren't here, but you're here when Dave backslid. He went back to pimping. Okay? Well, that doesn't mean that this was not legitimate. It means he backslid 20 years later. See that?
Right.
We weren't there. Is Benny a good guy? No, I doubt it. But I wasn't there when he was here. When he was booming. And he was a childlike faith and loved God. He was worshiper and God chaser. When he was in his 20s, we weren't there. You didn't see that, but God was there. And that's how he got these gifts. And the devil moved in. Whoa, this guy's got, we can't put up with this. So then they come to Benny and give him, hey, Benny, here's some prosperity for you. You deserve it. Uh-oh. Boop. Then it started. So the devil takes people through this rat race here, and then he tells everybody else to look at them. These people are crap. They're of the devil. Look at, they're satanic. Look what they're doing. Okay, you weren't there when they were doing the exact opposite. 20 years ago, 30 years ago, 40 years ago. But God was there. See? And so he takes you as you are. See, Billy Graham was great. Come as you are. That's how he takes you. He doesn't say, well, I can't take that guy because he's going to backslide 40 years from now. He doesn't do that. He takes you as you are, right now. So in there, you go for it. That's how mercy works. Hey, oh my God, he died drunk. The guy's a psycho. His whole ministry of Satan. No, it wasn't. You weren't there when he was on his hands and knees at the lake, crying his eyes out and vomiting when he was a full-blown alcoholic at age 9. You weren't there when you saw the Holy Ghost come on him.
Yeah.
Come on now. This is a sermon that'll preach. Steal it. You don't even need to give me a credit. You don't need it. Steal it. This baby will preach right here.
Yeah.
Crying out to God, filled with spirit, repenting. Oops, drunk. Well, you don't like that? Well, how about you want somebody to treat you like that? Oh, really? Come up here and I'll ask you a few questions. You ain't going to like the questions. There's nobody I can't ruin. Right? All you got to do is go look at the dirty laundry and not look at anything else. That's what the devil does. He whitewashes everybody. You're the devil. That's demonic. You're this. Wait a minute. This wasn't demonic. That wasn't demonic.
Of course, I know the answer to this question, but could the opposite happen? And you start off drunk and horrible and all these things, and then all those good things, the anointing, crying out to God, that comes later.
That I just said it. A.A. Okay. Allen started a full-blown alcoholic at 9.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Okay? Got saved, filled with the Spirit, got massive gift of healing, off the charts. Oops. Sunk back. Died. Oh, he died. He was a rotten person. No, stop. Yeah, that was rotten. And yeah, the devil got him. And, you know, didn't he get you? Yeah, are you perfect? I don't think so. If you've been in to see me, I know so. You're not there when those people got filled and God took them in 100%.
Praise God.
Paul was a murderer.
Now, most people don't fall. I'm not saying that. I'm just saying if they fall, I'm trying to show you the mechanics of what happened and when they fell. I'm not saying everybody's doing this. I'm just saying that it happens pretty regularly, and you need to be aware of how not to, you know, trash these people and condemn them to hell. That's God's business. But like she said, hey, if they've got flawed character and conscience problem, they probably picked up spirits. So you don't want them laying their hands on you. Same. A lot of them never went down the tube. Sister Etter didn't. John Lake didn't. Wigglesworth didn't. Yeah, some people fail, some don't. That's part of the human thing. Not everybody makes it, not everybody fails. It is what it is. But you are not to get befuddled by any of it. Knowledge leads to wisdom. Let's go to the next section. This one's even worse. Now, let's say you have a con artist. Let's go with Peter Popoff and Robert Tilton. Okay? You go to the service, and this person is a professional fraud. Okay, he is not a good man of God with character problems, right? He's got a seared conscience, right? Before these guys showed up, you had Marjo Gortner, right? I think he's still alive. So his mother and dad are Pentecostals, and he's 4 years old, and they taught him to preach. So he gets out on the stage and he starts preaching. He gets a big response, and then his parents go, wow, he's getting a bigger response than we are. So let's go with Marjo. And Marjo's getting oodles of attention. It's a four-year-old with all these people loving on him. Oh, it's got to be a rush. Come on, heroin's nothing. That's a rush. And he heads into learning how to preach. He learned how to preach. And did a good job. Preaching machine.
Oh, Mike.
Okay.
Can they have a demonic anointing, so to speak?
Yeah, it was all fraud. Everything that's fraud is demons. Mm-hmm. November 8th coming up. That's Demon Day. Mm-hmm. I thought it was Halloween. No, it's Election Day. Now, Marjo just learned to preach. And he had a knack for it, you know, like an actor, like whatever. Some people have giftings for carnal things or secular things. Yeah. Right? Singing. You know, I heard Whitney Houston sing. It sounded like an angel singing. You know. She started out in church and then said, hey, this other thing's working better. So she went over to the demon side. Right? But she had this unmatched gift of singing. This guy had a gift of preaching. He just learned how to do it, and the demons blessed him, and They told his parents, oh, he's saved. This is a real deal. The parents were deceived. They didn't see what was going on. And then his parents retired, and then he kept doing it, making money, preaching. And his system only works with Pentecostals, charismatics, and prophetics. That's the only way Marshall made any money, because those people are very soul, emotionally oriented Christians. Okay? Marshall would not go to Lutherans, Episcopals, and Methodists. They don't want him in, they're not interested, because they are not soul-based religious people. They just come in, kind of stoically go through the system. They like it nice and quiet. Marjo needs Pentecostals. Mostly it was Pentecostals. And he fooled everybody. Very convincing. Very talented. He'd watch other Pentecostal preachers and he'd mimic them. He'd learn it. You know, like an act, good at it. So then you got Tilton and Popoff, professional con artists with people getting healed. Now, how in God's name can somebody get healed at a Peter Popoff service? Here's how it works. I come in looking for Jesus, and Peter Popoff is up there. And he's preaching, and I'm looking to Jesus, the author and finisher. Bang, I got healed. I'm in a Popoff rally. Popoff did the same thing Marshall did. He watched Pentecostal preachers. He'd wear a little earpiece here. His wife would look at the prayer cards. Brenda Williams from Waukee, Illinois. Bad back. Peter, there's Brenda Mookley from Kukukli, Illinois. She's got a bad back. Is there a Brenda here? God told me there's a Brenda here. Now, are you from Illinois? That's me. Oh, my God, that's me. She thinks it's God. She comes forward. She's looking for Jesus, not Papa. He goes, you got a bad back. Oh, I got a bad back. Well, God's going to heal you, sister. Are you ready to be healed? Come on and pray with me, sister. Be healed. She gets up.
Yeah.
Healed at a Peter Popoff rally. God healed her. Not demons. God did. This person came to the Popoff rally looking for Peter. Peter, can you? Oh, we've got to get Peter to pray for us. But they didn't get healed. See the difference? So you can go to a con artist service, a fraud, and get healed. Yeah, I'm in trouble. Getting some emails on that one. Man looks on the outward appearance. God looks on the heart. Peter Popoff, fraud. Heart, good. The Holy Ghost goes past Popoff in mercy, looking for a good heart. He's a fake.
Yeah, I got tied up with him. He was sending me letters. Sent me little cute little trinket things, you know, and gave me all kind of prompts, and he was saying, with this money, you get your, you know, whatever you want, you know. And he said things, and I'd send him money. I was way back when I was kind of duh. But yeah, he's a con. He's good.
I'm glad you shared that, because that's explaining a lot. All right, now back to these frauds. Peter Popoff, Robert Tilton. It's a gimmick.
Yeah.
They just watched Pentecostal preachers. They learned how to preach. It's fake. The job is to get the money. That's exactly right. So then when you're at, Popoff learned that people can actually get healed if they're looking to Jesus at his meetings. So he preaches a pretty good message of Christ. it's uplifting, it's seeker-friendly, it's Jesus-oriented. See, he learned how to do it. And he does it with a lot of emotion, which attracts Pentecostals, charismatics, prophetic. They're emotionally based worshipers. Lutherans, Episcopal, Methodists, they don't do that. They're not interested in Peter Paul. They don't watch him. They're not, they don't care. No, it's an emotional soul hook that pulls you in. See? And the idea is to, you get on the mailing list and you support the ministry. Okay? And so you got to get a couple of healings going. Maybe that one's legitimate from God. Maybe that one was a adrenaline rush. Okay? Right? Maybe it was, like I was saying the other night, a fake leg lengthening. That's easy to fake. Okay, that's why I don't do it. I just stand back and then I pray over here because I don't want somebody to go, oh, you poor moving. It could be fake. It could be adrenaline. It could be a real one. The point I'm trying to make is the person that comes to the meeting may have sincerity and they are looking to Jesus, not the fraud on the podium. And Christ in his mercy reaches out to that person and then get healed in a fraud service. A few weeks ago, local ministry here had a huge meeting over in Chandler or Gilbert somewhere, a retreat. There was all kinds of people getting delivered in that service, even though the ministry's loaded with familiar spirits. What are you talking about? Like, this is crazy. No, it isn't. The people came with open hearts for God. God, and these people got healed. These were people pursuers. They didn't get healed. Or they got a fake healing, Todd Bentley healing. Is this making any sense? The reason I'm telling you this, I want you to understand how this system works because it looks weird. See, and the devil goes, he goes, if you go to Peter Popoff's service, he would tell us because we've got insightful information. He said, oh no, those are all satanic healings. He whitewashes everything and lumps everybody in the same bucket.
There's a scripture for this.
No.
And it's in Luke 9:50, where the disciples are saying yes for John. He saw someone driving off to his and he made him try to stop and he was not a company us. And so Jesus says, do not stop him, for whatever is not against you is for you.
Okay, now that scripture is a little different than what I'm talking about, but the point of that scripture was we don't have the book on deliverance here. That's part of the gospel. We're just taking a segment here at the Deliverance Center trying to help people. So if somebody else is doing deliverance, I'm not going to tell them to stop it. Right? Now, I did tell you, you know, these altar deliverances, I said, hey, they're good for soul wounds probably, but I do not recommend it for deliverance. Okay, I said that earlier. it's just not that effective. Because if there's no repentance, then there's no long-term deliverance. No renewing of the mind. Yeah.
When you look at this, we're talking about gifts in somebody's spirit, we're talking about sanctification, but what about the issue of salvation? I mean, somebody that has the power in the spirit, is it a given that person has been saved? Like, you know, like from what you've been doing, I feel like I'm cutting more slack for people like Jimmy Swaggart and Tammy and Jimmy Baker and Oral Roberts and Kathryn Kuhlman and so forth. I'm cutting them more slack based on what you're saying about character there. But I asked the question, and that's between them and God, but I asked the question, are they saved? You know, is even if they have a bad character, is a criteria that they have that they're saved?
Okay, now, that was another big load. Let's try and break that down. If you're saved, what you really mean is John 3, born again. And that means the Holy Spirit lives here. And that's what I was saying earlier. You're perfect. This part of you is perfect. The rest of it's flawed. This part's perfect. And when the trumpet sounds, this part hears it, and boom, you go. Okay? Jimmy Swaggart. I just went over that. Great man of God, massive gift of preaching, soul-winning monster. Uh-oh, lust demons got in. Started going to whores. How'd that happen? Well, obviously, it's a combination of things. Bad marriage, personal issues, whatever was going on with Jimmy, it led him to become a voyeur. You know, he liked to watch whores dance and take their clothes off. In other words, he liked a private pole dance. Okay, instead of going to a club, which he couldn't do because of marketing purposes, he got a pole dance in private. That's basically what it was. Well, those were lust demons that got into his body and hyperventilated his lustful nature. His marriage was sexually, and so boom, Jimmy's out there getting his jollies. And so God, as we mentioned earlier, sent in a trauma to help him. A trauma. He got caught. And he was on TV crying his eyes out. Right? And everybody forgave him. He went right back doing a great job. Powerful anointing, winning souls. And then over the years, guess who got back in? Uh-oh. They got in again. Then what happened? Okay, he got caught again. Picked up a prostitute in Indio, California, on the way back to Louisiana. Oops, he got caught again. Okay, then his ministry went from here to here, right? And in the last 10 years, he's built it back up to there, and he's booming again. Okay, now he's an old man, he's ready to die. Donnie's going to try and take it over, but he doesn't have the charisma or the anointing to be able to do it. You know, he's never going to make it. But the thing went from here to there again. See? Why? Because, listen, if you get caught sinning, you are eligible for mercy if you repent. Mercy will not forsake you. It doesn't stop until you're dead. If you're still alive, you got a shot at this thing. If you humble yourself and you repent, you can be restored, period. That's what the Bible says. That's what we teach here. You are able to be restored. Amen. It doesn't matter how bad it is. It doesn't matter what you did. You could be an Indio with a pack of whores. If you repent, you get restored. Steve?
Yeah.
You get restored if you repent, period. End of story. And Jimmy got restored. You ought to see his ministry now. Things booming, man. Packed houses, huge TV audiences, millions coming in, Jimmy Rowland. See? But before, he was living a living hell of his own making. Why? He doesn't understand deliverance. Jimmy doesn't do deliverance. He doesn't understand demons. Lust demon got in and took him. He became a voyeur, addicted voyeur, like porn addicts. They're addicted voyeurs. Fornication, that's grounds for divorce. His wife stood by him the whole time. She never left. You know? Yeah.
So you repent and you get restored. However, you still face consequences, right?
100%. His ministry tanked.
The choices that you make.
Oh, everybody reaps what they sow.
So the character that says we need to be blameless versus our anointing. There's a fine line of balance there.
Of course. You were told to be blameless.
Yeah.
Spiritually, your spirit man is blameless, right? Ephesians 1. But if you got character issues and you got conscience issues, you're going to be exhibiting sinful behaviors and attitudes. Okay? That's going to block your deliverance and your healing and cause all kinds of problems. Whatever a man sows, that shall he also reap. But God didn't take your gift away from you, and he didn't snatch your salvation. Oh, you swore. You dropped your keys. Damn it. Oh, you're not saved. Give me that saved. That did not happen. That did not happen. And grace covers these things. Now, if you willfully, of your own free will, turn your back on God, or you become a con artist like these three guys, Marjo, that's a different story. There's huge damnation in hell for that. I mean, you went out of your way to burn on that one. You weren't just sinning. In the perilous time shall come in the last days. Men shall be lovers of themselves. That's not lovers of yourself. You're whoring out God. You got problems you can't even dream about. I mean, I feel sorry for these guys. You know something funny? They interviewed Marjo one day. I saw the videotape of it. It was really interesting. He was telling somebody about his life and how he got into it and so on. And then he said, you know, I'm starting to feel some depression as I get older. He said, I don't know if I want to do this anymore. I don't feel good about it anymore. He says, all these people come to me and they're sincere and they're hurting. And I don't know. I think I might quit. Well, what was that? That was over the years, his conscience started to manifest, which it didn't when he was younger. It was all about. But I thought that interview was really interesting. Marshall Gortner, he's still alive. I think they're both alive. They're both still alive. Tilton's, I think, conning people in Florida, and Peter went to Canada. He's in Canada, booming. He had enough of Americans. He went up there to clean them out. And some people are getting healed, just like I said, you know. They're getting healed. Okay.
We're talking about the Jimmy Swagger. So I was around when he had all those problems with the prostitutes and everything.
Yeah.
But now I see him on TV again, preaching. But
yep.
If he hadn't gone through any type of deliverance, he's at risk of falling to the
Isn't everybody. Isn't everybody. Hmm? Isn't everybody. That's what we do here. We're trying to get people delivered so they don't fall back into that pit of.
So it's possible that someone like him, I'm just using him as an example, to fall back into lust.
Possible, or anybody.
And even though he's 80, 90 years old.
Anybody. Anybody. Yeah, I remember I read a medical study years ago. I forgot what year it was when Viagra came out. What year was that? Anybody remember that off the top of your head? Viagra? In the 80s, remember?
Yeah.
Viagra, what? I think it was in the 80s. I think it was in the mid or late 80s when they invented Viagra, okay? And I read this medical article about the spread of VD in Sun City. And I live in Sun City, and of course when I go outside, I'm very cautious about, I sneak over to my car. So the elderly people had lust demons, but their body wasn't performing. So Viagra gave their body a chance to perform, so the lust demon said, hey, there's Elsie, she's looking hot. On the dance floor there, she's 70-something. And of course, the women, they over there, hey, if you can perform, you move in, period. They're starved for affection and love, obviously. You get older and you don't have any sex life anymore and there's nothing there. And this Viagra was causing VD to spread in Sun City. See, and before I moved out there, I called the county and said, can you fumigate? A little bit before. That's how the system works. The demons stay in the body until the person drops dead. They leave the body, then they go to another family member. They always stay in that family tree. Okay, I'm running out of time here, so I wanted to mention this other subject, okay? About 2 years ago or something, I saw Trump on TV with Herschel Walker. I think he was holding a rally in Pennsylvania. It was two and a half years ago. Does anybody know when that was? Well, let's just pretend it was that. And I go, when I saw Herschel Walker, I go, oh my God, no. No. He's got borderline personality disorder. I says to my wife, who couldn't care less what I'm talking about. She's not interested, but I say it anyway because it's a venting situation. I said, honey, the Herschel Walker's running for the Senate. This is going to be bad news for the Republicans. They should have never done it. You know why? They didn't investigate his background. Why? Because this is one of the worst mental illnesses anybody can have. And in this person's background is a nightmare. I said, when he runs for office, they're going to go back in his history and they're going to dig up crap you can't conceive nor believe. I'm talking about police reports, restraining orders, beatings, murders, knives, guns, everything. Okay? This mental illness here is a nightmare on Elm Street. There's few mental illnesses worse than this one. It's bipolar on steroids. And almost all of them have a violent component to it. Yeah, and sure enough, this year, they went into his background. Guess what they found? The trail of borderline personality disorder. Abortions, cops, restraining orders, divorces, multiple kids, four kids with four different women. They all hate him. Why? These demons are on steroids. They're monsters. And they always start here with these two spirits right here, this one and that one. Okay? This is the rejection demon. He gets in first. And then he lets in this one, the rebellion demon, and the borderline patients. That's the dominant spirit. And they are vicious, angry, murderous, hateful, rageful. And they worked with Walker for years. Now, how do they get in? Walker's textbook. Chronic, severe child abuse. Walker was destroyed as a child. Systematic, chronic, repetitive bullying in school. Verbal abuse, physical beatings for years. All these demons got in. All of them. The rejection got in, then the lust demons jumped in. There they are. Four kids, four different women. Chronic adultery. Borderline patients are rarely single and frequently divorced. Do you know why? They are sex maniacs. Borderline personality disorder in a female always guarantees a boyfriend. They are spectacular in bed. Chronic superstar lust disorder. Passionate, kinky, anything. You want sex? You got it. You want it often? You get it consistently and constantly. These lust demons are monsters. So is rage. So is hate. And so is violence. You think bipolar is a problem? It is. This is bipolar off the cliff. I said to my wife, she wasn't listening, I said, honey, if he runs for Senate, he's going to get slaughtered. Because they will go back. Huh?
He's got one good thing going for him.
What's that?
He went to the University of Georgia.
You, well, no.
And all of a sudden, they
borderline personality disorder. Doesn't care if you're a freak athlete. Walker was one of the greatest athletes in the history of the country. If you went back 200 years, he would still be standing there. This guy is a physical freak of nature. Okay? Borderline demons don't care. They don't care. They'll take a disabled person. They'll take the greatest athlete in history. He's one of them.
Oh, yeah.
The guy's at this level, off the charts. Great. Okay? So they worked with him for years. They got the medication combination to the point where he wasn't killing people and burning down buildings. And so then he kind of became a normal person.
Yeah.
Okay? And so he developed conservative values, and he has a good heart. You know, he really does, down deep in here, when the demons are not controlling him, he's actually a good person. And in borderline patients, you'll see those distinct personalities. This monster will come up, and then this loving person will come up, and then this passionate person will come out, and this fun person will come out. They're like a carnival. See? But it's all a giant funhouse mirror. Nothing is real. And so the Democrats said, wait a minute. This guy had an abortion. Now he's telling us he's pro-life. This guy beat up some chick. He's telling us he respects women. Borderlines do everything wrong. You never have them run for public office. Never. Because once they're investigated, you've got nothing but trouble. They'll dig up everything in your past, and there's so much to dig up.
Oh, I just wanted, it's borderline personality disorder, not bipolar.
Oh,
yeah,
so
I just want to make sure.
No, I'm right here. Borderline personality, that's bipolar on steroids. That's at another level. You know, you'd have a mood swing on a bipolar here. You'd have a borderline here. Ah!
You know, when we look at Herschel Walker, then we have to say, what about Reverend Warnack, the guy that's running against him? If you check that guy out, I mean, what us voters, the problem us voters have is hell if you do or don't vote.
Stop, sir.
Yeah.
Don't get me on Warlock. Oh.
Oh, yeah.
He's floating in familiar spirits. Don't start me on Warlock. I was just pointing out this, okay? I'm pointing out borderline. I'm just using Herschel as an example. I'm not saying let's focus on Herschel. He's a good guy and everything. I got nothing against Herschel. I'm explaining how this works, okay? Warnock's totally different. He doesn't have borderline. He's got monstrous seared conscience. Nothing bothers this guy. He'll cheat, he'll lie and cheat, and it's just like, pass us off. It's not, he has no conscience at all. He'll do anything. Anything. This, though, is horrible. These demons are just off the charts dangerous. They're dangerous. Literally dangerous. Warnock's demons are not dangerous. He'll beat you up or he'll evict you. But he's not going to strangle you to death. These demons will strangle you to death. Yeah.
Someone who has borderline personality disorder, do they have the capability of recognizing it in themselves?
Yeah, they recognize it. Yeah. Herschel did. He went to therapy for years. They experimented with medications 1,000 times.
But yeah. Deliverance is what's needed.
He never got into deliverance. He never repented. He wanted to change, but he never repented to God, and he never got these demons out. Now he claims he doesn't have borderline. Well, what's happening there? The demons just take a dive and say, oh, we're not going to manifest for a while until he gets in the Senate. Oh, man. He'll tear the Senate down like Samson.
So is there regular borderline? I mean, is there regular personality disorder and then borderline? Or is it just borderline personality disorder?
Well,
are there
they're all personality disorders. See, there's a category in the DSM for personality disorders. This is one type of personality disorder. I pointed it out because Herschel Walker has it, and I wanted to use it as an illustration.
Is it multiple personalities?
No, this is borderline personality disorder. You're talking about dissociative identity disorder. That's a different mental illness, but it's in the category of...
Okay.
Have you ever had anybody get delivered from BID?
No.
From this?
No. No, they don't stay around long enough. And again, here's the main spirit. This one here. The rebellion demon is the one that kiboshes us. They'll stay there for a while, and then that thing will manifest, and they'll bolt. Or they'll turn on you. They'll start calling you names. They'll attack you. I've never had one delivered.
So with like multiple personalities, how do you know you could be getting them great deliverance, and that's just one personality, and another one, like... can manifest as soon as they leave the center, right? I mean,
not really. No, it doesn't really work like that. What's happening there is the spirits inside the person's soul have different personalities.
Right.
That's in this category here. That's a severe mental illness. Okay, that's in the oh my God category. Okay, it's not an anxiety disorder. It's not depression. Those we see them in here all the time. They get healed all the time here. We see them healed all the time. DIDs and BPDs, no, we do not see healed all the time. Those demons are up here. Yeah, you know, you don't cast them out based on each personality.
No, I'm not.
You know, it's the spirits manifesting different personalities.
How do you know, though? That's what I mean. How do you know you're not dealing with? How do you deal with all the personalities?
Well, no, what you're really saying is, how do you get them delivered?
How do you get them delivered?
And so you have to figure out while you're working with the person what their real personality is.
That's my question.
Okay, so that takes you some interpersonal interaction. You got to spend a little bit of time with them. You got to know what the real person is. Because they're in there. Okay?
Yeah.
And then you got to get the real person to turn on the fake ones.
Yeah, okay, gotcha.
That's how you get them healed.
I know a narcissist that I got to come down here a couple times, and this individual told me that he would never come down here again, and that I'm crazy to come down here, you know.
Well, no, let's not get into that, because I've heard some rumors about you. But what he's talking about here is that rebellion demon on this hand here is majorly involved with narcissism and borderline. Huge. And narcissism is the only mental illness Satan had. And it cost him his kingdom. These people are not sick. They are beyond sick. And if you've ever been married or hang around somebody who has NPD, you know exactly what I'm talking about. A narcissist is, I mean, an avalanche of agony. And you can talk to them, you're blue in the face, and their demons just nod, oh yeah, and they go right back to it. Yeah. Do you have any other serious mental illnesses you want to bring up? Strange group. Okay, I'm going to close now with this. Ready? We are getting a lot of these, not a lot of borderlines in here. Thank God. I pray and ask the Lord to send them to the Lutheran church. We are getting a lot of schizophrenics. Ready?
Yeah.
Okay. Here is your chart for the schizophrenics. Okay. Same demons. Rejection lets in rebellion, and then he lets in lust, then he lets in fear, all the deal. They let They come flooding in. All based on abuse. Now, in order for these people to get healed, I have seen schizophrenics healed and schizoaffectives. I took a copy of chapter 21 in Pigs in the Parlor, okay? Have that in your counseling session. You got Pigs in the Parlor? Copy that chapter 21. You've got to have it. And then I took a copy of that chart there in the book, okay? And you got to go through this chart after they read this like 10 times. You got to go through this chart like you're talking to a two-year-old and show them exactly what happened to them. Now, you see that rejection demon? That came in when your mother kept screaming at you when you were three. You remember that? And then your dad was left you, and then your uncle molested you. And that, see that lust demon? He got in when your uncle molested you. See it there? And you have to go through this like you're talking to a second grader. And you have to have a lot of patience with them, and you have to let them digest it slowly. And you have to relate it to something they can relate to. So I say, see that abuse that happened to you? Here's how that lust demon got in. Your uncle had anal sex with you. Remember that? Yeah, okay, well, that's where your lust demons are coming from. You just point that out. You show them the chart, and you go over it real patiently. They need time to absorb it, because in their head, sometimes these schizophrenia demons are talking to them while you're talking to them. And they're going, whoop!
Yeah.
Don't worry from the help. And they're talking in a different voice and a different person. It's spooky. And then sometimes the demon will pop up. He's not doing that. Hey, I'm not talking to you. Now, Bob? Yeah, Mike. Okay, now let's go back to this. See, you got to be patient with it. There's no way to see them instantly delivered. We don't have that kind of anointing around here.
Have you found that those individuals just bow out? Like
most of them bow out, yeah.
Yeah.
And again, the problem is this demon here, the spirit of rebellion. If you get too close to him, he'll pitch a fit. Okay? And then, if somebody could, you mind passing this out for me? Honey. Yeah, then I signed a contract for $1,200 with a local artist, and he made this chart. It's really something else. I go through how they got the schizophrenia demon, okay? Unless there's witchcraft involved or somebody puts a spell on you, you don't get the schizophrenia demon until later in life, usually late teens, early 20s. You get all these demons right out the gate. See, rejection came in when your dad beat the crap out of you. You got molested. This one came in. But this schizophrenia demon gets in later in life. They let him in. They can't just let him right in. He won't get in. He can't get in. But by the time they're 21, 22, boop, they let him in.
I noticed I had, for like 1 month, I had 3 people in a row who had schizophrenia, and they were acting exactly the same, and they were all Muslim. They all had a Muslim father.
Right.
Is there some...
There's an enormous connection. Schizophrenics in their family tree usually have some form of witchcraft or masonry or Mormonism or something like that. Superpowered demons up here breed schizophrenia spirits. You can't get a schizophrenia spirit by regular sinning. Nope, you don't have it. Yeah.
And then how's that, the paranoid, how's that fit in?
That's let in by these. It's a fear demon. They live in chronic fear. All the time, they're afraid of everything.
Well, those type of demons or those type of issues are naturally, or become paranoid. Is that right?
Well, yeah. Paranoid is in you know, levels, but I'm talking about the schizophrenia level of fear demons. Those are very powerful. Yeah. Anybody can have anxiety disorder or paranoia, and we see those healed all the time. Those are pretty easy to heal. Yeah, so you go through this list with him. There's a rejection demon. He got in first. And then he opened the door to these other ones that came in. And usually it's fear, lust, lying spirit, and the spirit of infirmity. That's the one you're going to face most often while you're doing your deliverances, okay? So what she just said is telling me that God is preparing her for this kind of ministry because he keeps sending her schizophrenic. So that's a red flag. The Holy Ghost trying to get her ready to go. See that?
Yeah.
Praise God.
Yeah, because not everybody can do this kind of ministry, okay? But we're going to be getting a lot more of them in here. And the demons will talk to them in their head while you're trying to help them. You know, it's frustrating. What they're trying to do is distract them. It's like ringing a bell or something. Bing, 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 bing. Don't listen to him. That's what they're doing. Yeah. And this is your chart. And the thoughts they put in their head are always negative. Did you get one of these?
She's getting
negative. Their mind is filled with negative thoughts. Constantly. Bombarded. Negative, negative.
They're always nagging.
The demons?
A person with schizophrenic personality would always nitpick on everything. Now you're doing this wrong, you're doing that wrong. Is that possible?
Is it possible? Yeah, that's a critical spirit. That's a different demon. Yeah, they could have that spirit. But not every one of them have it.
Is a person with schizophrenic personality, could they also be a narcissist?
Not usually, no. No, narcissists don't have schizophrenia. They don't hear voices. They're sicker than that. Now, see that? They're always trying to get the person to live out of their emotions. You're trying to get them to live out of the Word of God and their spirit man. See that? And later on in life, these demons take their mind completely. They don't know their loved ones. They don't know you. Nothing. They're gone.
So when you're working with one and you go over that chart with them, you have to actually figure out where each one of those spirits came in their history?
Not necessarily, no. Mm-mm. No. It depends on the person's response, if they're listening to you. Most of it is based on the person's motivation. You know, if the schizophrenia's not gone to the point where they're totally out of their mind and they're able to receive truth, you got a shot at getting them delivered. If they're way over the ledge, probably not. They're gone.
So they lie a lot and they exaggerate?
No, the demons lie to them a lot. They tell them lies all the time about everything. You, God, religion, you know. Two issues to close. Some of these demons may let in a religious spirit, not all of them. And some of them may let in this one here, this murder demon. Okay. Now, for example, the guy at Aurora, Colorado years ago, he goes into a movie theater one night with automatic weapons and starts mowing down everybody watching a movie. Remember that? The Colorado mass murder. He was schizophrenic and he had a murder attachment. These people are extremely dangerous. They're the school killers. Mass murder. They're capable of it. If they don't have that, there's no problem. You'll know them all your life and they'll never hit anybody, nothing. Okay? So if you sense that, you got to take precautions. Borderlines, you can be on guard. He's in there. And he'll use your face as a punching bag in 2 seconds. Not a schizophrenic, not normally. Okay? It's not multiple personality disorder. There's a bunch of demons in their head. They'll talk to him, then they'll talk to each other. They'll talk back and forth. And usually while you're trying to help them. Trying to, bing, 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 don't listen to him. So they'll start up a conversation. A lady comes to my office one day, as I'll close with this then. I'm sorry I went over. Get a copy of this out of your pigs in the parlor, okay? Take a copy of this, particularly you, and go ahead and go into your ministry. You have to have an enormous amount of patience to minister to schizophrenics. If to minister to borderlines, you've got to have an office with an exit door. I would not recommend you minister them alone. Two-man ministry on borderlines, I say, is a minimum. You might want Steve to join you in case it gets really out of hand. Give Steve a call. He'll come over. Schizophrenics normally will not beat you up. Okay, they might yell at you and give you a good cussing, but that's him manifesting. He you touched on something close to a nerve. Now he flares up, and he launches an attack at you. You don't take anything personal. Nothing. None of this is personal.
One more thing on narcissism. I've noticed that they usually are like type A personalities, and they could be very successful people, very wealthy people, but you can't seem to appeal them at all.
Well, it goes beyond that. Most of them have high IQs, and many of them are successful people, chronic manipulators of everybody in their environment. I've seen many successful, wealthy narcissists, but they don't give a rat's fanny about you at all, but they make it seem like they do. They'll fake you out so fast you won't even believe it. Professional, okay? So we don't like narcissists around here. I refer all them to Kelly. And we don't like borderlines with rage issues manifesting. I send all those over to Rick. But we do take in schizophrenics. And we're going to start a new ministry for schizophrenics. And guess who's going to run it?
Dan.
That woman right there. All right. Let's pray. Father God, I had another great Saturday here. And I thank you for that. It's a privilege to be here on Saturdays and get all these questions. I did the best I could to share some things that you showed me over the years. I pray they bless somebody. Now, Lord, we want to go into our prayer service, and we want to see the Holy Spirit move. He's the most important person, not me. And so we get to give him his time to do what he wants, whatever he says. I'll go for it. I hope everyone will. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Thanks,
you're dismissed. I'll see you next month, fourth Saturday of every month at noon. I'm right here for deliverance training class. Okay? If you need prayer, please come down to the front. We got a lot of good people here to pray with you. Thank you.